Good morning. I'm Pastor Steve Lee, and I want to welcome you to Living Word Online, our digital presence online with our worship services during this COVID crisis, and want to welcome you. This has been a period of time of adaptation, doing things a little bit differently, as we all have learned how to do. And so we've had a challenging time, but also a very interesting time of adaptation. How do we continue to provide ministry and mission to those folks who belong to our fellowship, but also to the broader community? Of course, being online, we have the opportunity to speak not just to our own folks, but to others who might visit us online. And so we've got a fairly steep learning curve here. That's a curve that we don't want to flatten. We've steepened it. And so we welcome you, and come walk with us as we're learning day by day. New capabilities about video, about how to do outreach, about how to minister in these periods of sequestration. So stay with us. There's exciting stuff happening with our online stuff, but also with our folks rolling up their sleeves and using this time, not just sitting on their hands, but rolling up their sleeves and working to improve things at Living Word here in Orland Park. So for instance, if you go online, look at our newsletter, if you contact us, you can find out more about what we're doing to improve the facilities so that when we do reopen, it'll be an even nicer facility in a great location than it already is. And so stick with us and welcome. Today, this Sunday, May 3rd, is what we Lutheran Christians call Good Shepherd Sunday. Good Shepherd Sunday. And this is the day when we focus on those portions of the Bible, of Scripture, that talk about Jesus being our Good Shepherd. And so one of the things that we offer is a devotional that you can get. You can download this as well. You can contact the church office if you want this sent to you. We'd be happy to provide that to you. And we have devotional readings this week, especially talking about the Lord is our Good Shepherd. And so you can have some devotional readings there. For service today, we are looking especially at the 23rd Psalm, probably the most beloved psalm that in the Bible, the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. I want for nothing. We'll walk through with the Good Shepherd this beautiful psalm today, talk about how this applies to us in our lives, especially during this time of fear, uncertainty, sometimes, unfortunately, sickness, and even death. And how do we deal with these things that come up in life and shock and surprise us all? And the Lord is there to walk with us through that shadow of the valley. That's the message of the 23rd Psalm. So we want to welcome you here today. And we're going to begin with a particular setting of a song, The Lord's My Shepherd. And we actually have this same song in a couple of different settings today. One is our opening song, and then the other one is our message intro today. And I really like them both, and I had a hard time choosing between the two, and really liked them both. So we're going to present both of these to you, and one by Stuart Townend, and then the other one by the Smith Ensemble. So we trust that you will enjoy these presentations as well. So welcome to Living Word Online.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still, still waters. His goodness restores.
Begin our worship service in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. For our scripture reading, once again, we are going to read the 23rd Psalm, Psalm 23. When we talk about this in the message and walk through it, we're going to give you a modern translation, the NIV translation of that. But for the reading portion here, the beauty of the King James language really is appropriate for reading this 23rd Psalm. It's the traditional reading for the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And now we have the Smith Ensemble presenting another setting for The Lord is My Shepherd. I invite you to follow along in the posted online worship folder that we have, including an outline of the message. It will probably help you in walking through this passage of Scripture, this 23rd Psalm. And indeed, we do call this walking with the Good Shepherd. And life is a journey, isn't it? It's a road that we walk. The metaphor has been used by many, many different people. It's a journey, and sometimes there's obstacles. Sometimes there's roadblocks. Sometimes there's detours. Sometimes we encounter enemies on the road of one kind or another. The current COVID-19 crisis, this pandemic, has been compared to a war. And the coronavirus is the enemy. And we have to fight this enemy. And in any war, there are casualties. In any war, there's a great expenditure of effort, blood, sweat, and tears. That's the language of warfare. There's difficulty. There's questions. There's fear that comes along with any unknown, uncertain outcome. Will I be okay? Will I survive? Will life ever go back to normal? What will the new normal be? That's the language we've heard. The new normal. What is this social distancing? How long is that going to last? What about my job? What about the health of myself and my family, those that I love? And this isn't just about a virus. And these issues don't go away when the virus eventually will go away, when a vaccine gets developed. But there are other things that can happen in life that can blindside us on our road of life, on our journey through life. There are things that can happen. How do we deal with these things? And here's a key point I want to make right now. Very important for us all to understand. Even when we don't realize God is there, He's there. Even when we think we're alone, we're not. Even if we question whether anybody cares, the Lord cares. No matter what our situation in life, even if we've rejected God and His Son, Jesus Christ, He is not, does not want to reject us. The Bible says that while we were sinners, in fact, goes even further to say, while we were enemies of God, Christ not only came, He died for you and for me. And the scripture poses the question, who would die for a good person? And yet God demonstrates His own love for us, that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. That's real sacrificial love. Jesus hanging on the cross, when people were ridiculing Him and mocking Him and insulting Him, prayed this prayer, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Christ died for us. He's there for us. He lives today. This is the Easter season. We remember that our Good Shepherd lives. He's not just a dead idea. He's not just an inspirational story. He's a living God who died for us. And because of his death, we have the forgiveness of sins. Because of his life, we too can live forever. And it's a free gift just simply by trusting him. But there's an abundant life he came to give us. He says, I came that they might have life, that you might have life, and have it abundantly. That's the promise. So it's not a problem about God's love and care and concern for us on our road, on our journey through life. What is the issue? What is the problem? If it's not God's problem, it's ours, isn't it? How often do we not recognize God on the road that we walk in life? How often do we figure we're on our own? How often do we not trust him? How often do we not even know what his promises are from the Word of God? How often do we disobey his commandments and say, you know what? I think I've got a better idea. I don't want anybody shoving his rules down my throat. And I'm going to do what I want to do. And then we pay the inevitable price for our poor choices, don't we? But God is still there. If there's an issue, it's us. What will we do? What choices will we make? God's there. All we need to do is open our eyes. And God wants us to open our eyes. He empowers us through his word, through his Holy Spirit, to see him, to realize he doesn't just exist, but he cares for you and for me. And he's provided a good shepherd for us who walks with us through that shadow valley, in the words of the 23rd Psalm. We have that shepherd. Well, how does this translate into the life we live? The psalm was written 3,000 years ago. What does this mean for us today in practical terms that we can relate in our culture, in our country, in the 21st century, during this COVID crisis, and then other times of life? How do we connect with these words and make them real for us? So let's walk with the Good Shepherd. Walking with the Good Shepherd. Today we consider the most beloved psalm in the Bible, Psalm 23. Here is a clear portrait of Jesus' love for us. How will we respond? Now, right away, I want to point out that I'm talking about Jesus' love. The psalm was written 1,000 years before Jesus walked the earth. So how can this be about Jesus? Well, in the Old Testament, we see prophecies about the coming Messiah. And Jesus fulfills those prophecies, including, in this case, very especially, the 23rd Psalm. If you want to know who God is, if you want to have a relationship with him, if you are lonely for that divine connection, all you have to do is look at Jesus, God's messenger, God's Messiah, God's Savior sent for us all, God's good shepherd. Okay. Now, we have a picture that we posted with the worship folder online with the service outline. And I was looking online at pictures of Jesus, the Good Shepherd. That was what I was searching for. And I looked through a lot of different pictures. And the one I chose shows a picture of Jesus. And of course, we don't know what he actually looked like. There are no cameras back then. We don't know. But this is a kind of a typical depiction of Jesus and how we think he might have looked. But the picture I finally settled on was Jesus holding a black sheep. Not a white lamb, but a black lamb. I think about the expression, the black sheep of the family. And I come from a very interesting family. And I won't get into gory details of the extended generations and the issues that I've discovered over the years that some of my ancestors had. You probably had your own stories, family stories, in your extended family. And you may have one or more people in your extended family. It may fit, this description may fit you yourself. Being considered the black sheep of the family. So I thought, you know what, this is appropriate, having Jesus hold this black lamb, this black sheep. Because the truth of the matter is that in God's human family, we are all black sheep. What do I mean by that? Hey, we say, I haven't robbed any banks, I've never served jail time, I pay my taxes, I love my family, I try and do what's right. Yeah, but how many of us have sinned against the ever-living God? How many of us have turned our backs on Him? How many of us have disregarded His commands or His promises, refused to believe His promises, most especially about Jesus, our Good Shepherd? The truth of the matter is we are all born black sheep. We are all born with an inclination to sin. If you have a child, do you have to teach that child to be good or bad? And what do they learn on their, by themselves? What is innate in them versus what they have to be taught? Now, you may have a remarkable child. I don't know. But in my experience, I see that children have to be disciplined. Children have to be taught right from wrong. Children have to be taught especially not to be selfish, self-centered. Think of others. Be nice to people. There's even been a description about things I learned in kindergarten. The idea being the lessons we learn early in life are applicable all through life. Be nice. Learn to share. Say good things about people, not bad things. Don't pick fights. Try to be a peacemaker. Work hard. Do your best. Simple life lessons. But these have to be taught to our children because we are born in sin. And we have to, even when we learn these lessons, how often do we violate these things as adults? Well, we're all sinners. We're all black sheep. That's the fact of the matter. Now, here we've got choices. The Good Shepherd walks with us. We're born in sin. How will we decide? Well, first of all, walking through this 23rd Psalm, we see, first of all, that the Good Shepherd refreshes. And the question, the choice is this: will I drink? Have you ever had been working on a really hot day, get very, very thirsty, and then you have a cold drink? And it just really hits the spot. There's nothing like that. Well, in the Bible, Jesus says that He is the living water. And that when we come to Him spiritually, we will never thirst again. He's there. He's the Good Shepherd. He's walking with us on the road. He's offering us the fresh water, the fresh spring water spiritually. But do we drink in the desert of life? Or do we turn away and then even blame God for not providing that drink? The Lord is my shepherd, the psalm says, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. Have you allowed the Lord to refresh your soul? Well, how does this work? Again, in the 21st century, 3,000 years after those words were written. Here's how it works. We build our life on the foundation of Christ and His Word. That means in practical terms, we spend time in the Word of God. We learn what that Word says, what God tells us. So for instance, my wife Elaine and I, we have a regular family devotion. And now with growing children, it's her and and I that do this. She and I, we have our family, our marriage couple devotion. And when we don't have that devotion, we notice that life tends to get frayed around the edges. That we're not centering ourselves with the Lord in the morning. And we move into our day, we rush around, and we find ourselves having problems, having issues of one kind or another. But when we center ourselves with the Lord, with the Good Shepherd in the morning, get our day off to a good start. God's mercies are new every morning. That's what the Word of God says. And when we imbibe, when we drink from that living water, His Word, our day goes better, and yours will too. Spend some time with the Lord. We right now, during this time of isolation, one of the things that I've started doing, been doing this actually for the whole time, pretty much of this isolation period, social isolation, is we have every evening what we call quiet time with Pastor Lee. And I go online, it's a Zoom meeting, and then anybody that wants to check in can sign into this meeting, and then we'll talk. And we'll talk about the events of the day, we'll check and see how people are doing, have you heard any news, what's going on, and also have a little devotion frequently, a little drinking from that living water of the Word, and then pray together. Pray for people that need prayer. Pray for those families who've lost loved ones to this COVID virus. Pray for other things as well. These are quiet times to pull away and be with the Good Shepherd. It's a refreshing time. What are you doing to refresh yourself? I've done a lot of critical incident, what's called critical incident response, disaster response over the years, and there are protocols for how to deal with the emotional impact and even the spiritual impact that a crisis can cause and the stresses that can cause and the worries and the fears that are engendered. And there are certain methodologies for dealing with this. But how often do people turn to alcohol, drugs, other dysfunctional things that only wind up adding to the problems? One of the simple things I talk about in dealing with crises is make sure you hydrate. Make sure you get enough water to drink. Well, there's a spiritual application into that we drink from that living water, that we do the healthy routines. We do the things that will help instead of hurt ourselves and our loved ones. Now, if you want to be part of this particular fellowship, this quiet time with Pastor Lee, contact our church office, and we can give you instructions about how to sign into that Zoom meeting as well. We'd be happy to do so. Number two. Again, the Good Shepherd's there. The Good Shepherd has an invitation. How will we respond? The Good Shepherd guides. That's what the psalm says. The Good Shepherd guides. Will I follow? God doesn't force Himself on anybody. If you want to turn your back on God, as we say, it's a free country. You do what you want. You can be as stupid as you want to be. But the invitation's there. He's willing to guide us. The psalm says, He guides me along the right paths for His name's sake. Will you follow? Will I follow that guidance? And it says, along the right paths, these are the paths that don't lead to death and destruction, but lead to life and joy and peace and love. For His name's sake, it says. What does that mean, for His name's sake? That's an old kind of expression. It means that the names of God reveal His character, who He is. He must be true to Himself. He will not exist apart from the names that describe His character in His activity, who He is. So, for instance, the name Jesus means Jehovah saves. God saves. Jesus will not deny Himself. He must save. He had to go to that cross for you and for me to save us for his name's sake. That's just one of many, many examples. He's the Prince of Peace. He gives us peace. For many years, I was what's called a peace officer out in California in law enforcement. And I often marveled at how often these peace officers that bring peace to society, that are peacemakers, fail to have peace in their own lives. Jesus is the ultimate peace officer. He is the peacemaker. He gives us peace. He is the Prince of Peace. He guides. Will we follow? Number three, the Good Shepherd comforts. Will I trust? Will I trust his comforting presence? Or will I be suspicious and back off and tell him, no, I want nothing to do with you. I don't trust you. Yeah, you're saying it, but I don't believe it. I doubt. Will you trust him, the Good Shepherd? Look at his nail-scarred hands. If you want the proof of the Good Shepherd's love, look at his nail-scarred hands that were wounded at the cross for you. He who died for us, will he not also give us what we need inside, spiritually? Trust him. The psalmist says in verse 4 of the 23rd Psalm, even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. They comfort me. And why do they comfort? What is that rod? What is that staff? These are the instruments of wood that the shepherd would use as a tool or even as a weapon. We still have that instrument of wood. It's called the cross of Jesus Christ. And that was his weapon against the devil and against sin. That was his tool to help us. When I look at the cross, I am comforted. I'm reminded that he who died for me will be there for me as my good shepherd on my journey, on my road. Will I trust him? If you want to learn to trust him, look at the cross of the good shepherd and realize the proof of his love, of his comfort is there. And then fourthly, wrapping up this 23rd Psalm, the good shepherd prepares a table. That's what the psalmist says. Will I come to that banquet table? You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. What are your enemies? Who are your enemies? God has prepared a table for you, a table of blessing, a banquet table of blessing. Even in the presence of whatever the enemies are, he comes to us in our presence, in that presence. He is present. He has prepared a table. It's a table of blessing through his promises, the promises of his word, through the way he actually superintends life. We are not prohibited from having bad things happen to us. Bad things happen to good people. It's true. Good people get sick. Good people die sometimes. Good people have accidents. There's all kinds of things that can happen to each and every one of us. But it's the internal belief that we have to deal with all of these things that beset a fallen human race, an imperfect world that was brought down in sin by the devil and by our own rebellion against God. God is present in that imperfect world to give us every tool we need to cope with whatever it is that we face, if we will just walk with him as he walks with us. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. That's what the psalmist says. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This life is not the end of things. That's the ultimate hope and peace that we have. is that because of what our Good Shepherd has done, we have a promise of eternal life if we just believe. Just believe what he says. Well, today on Good Shepherd Sunday, I give you an invitation to take a look at the Good Shepherd. And we black sheep, you know, it's an interesting thing. The blood of Jesus washes us white. It's an interesting thing that the Good Shepherd has become a sheep himself. In Scripture, it talks about Jesus being the Lamb of God, whose shed blood takes away the sin of the world. The Good Shepherd knows our situation. He's been there himself. He's been that spotless Lamb of God, that pure Lamb of God who sacrificed himself to make us white, clean inside, where it really counts. All of us, clean inside. We now wear the white robes of righteousness, washed in the blood of the Lamb. That's what the book of Revelation talks about. Well, now I want to give you this invitation. Will you drink? Will you follow? Will you trust? Will you come? Let's pray. Now I invite you to come into the presence of our Good Shepherd in prayer. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for sending the Good Shepherd to us, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who lived a life we failed to live, who suffered for our sin, who died on the cross for us all, who sacrificed himself to protect his black sheep that he has now made white. Lord, thank you for cleaning out our hearts on the inside, making us white on the inside with cleanliness, divine cleanliness. Thank you, Lord, that we've been washed in the blood. Thank you, Lord, that by the shedding of blood, by Jesus, the Good Shepherd's blood, we've been made pure once again. Thank you, Lord, that he became a sheep himself in order to be our worthy shepherd. He became the holy, righteous Lamb of God, by whose blood we are made clean and given eternal life. Help us always to trust that shed blood. Trust that Lamb of God, Lord. Thank you that we've been made pure and clean once again. Thank you that it's a gift simply by believing, simply by receiving him. Thank you, Lord, that we have the power by your Holy Spirit to do so. Father in heaven, today we gather in prayer. We confess to you that all too often, each one of us, we have been wandering sheep. We have left the side of our Good Shepherd. We've left that good path of life that he has laid out for us. We've refused to be refreshed by the living water. We've refused to be guided by your word, by our Good Shepherd. We have not followed him. Lord, we confess that we've even refused to be comforted in our sorrow and our sadness and our sin. We refuse to believe that, yes, indeed, our sins have been taken away. We refuse to believe your promise that you actually care and do love us, and that you actually have provided a way of salvation for us. We confess that we've lacked faith and trust in our Good Shepherd. Lord, we refuse sometimes to believe that you have indeed prepared a table for us in the presence of our enemies even now. And we've thought that we've been on our own, alone in life. But that's a lie that we bought into, Lord. We confess that lie. Lord, and we thank you that in all of these problems on our road in life, walking on that road, that we do have this Good Shepherd. We do have the forgiveness of sins that he's won. He does hold us in his arms. He died for us even when we were rebellious and sinners. And therefore, he will give us anything that we truly need in life now, in life forever. Lord, thank you that we have the free forgiveness of sins by his sacrifice. Lord, thank you for this Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Now, Lord, we turn to you in prayer. We pray for those for whom we have concerns. We pray that you would be there and answer our prayer, hear our prayer, and answer our prayer. Lord, we name particular people now, but we also name those people and situations in our life. And we lay these concerns and these prayers, spoken and unspoken, before your throne of grace, trusting that you hear us, trusting that your Holy Spirit presents these prayers before your throne of grace, trusting that indeed you do hear because you are a loving Heavenly Father, trusting that because of your Son, Jesus Christ, we have an intercessor at your throne of grace. Lord, today we pray, continue to pray for all those who've been affected by the coronavirus. We pray for health, strength, and patience until this is over. We pray for comfort in the loss of loved ones. We pray for strength for those who have this sickness. We pray, Lord, you protect those who remain healthy, keep them from getting this. We pray, Lord, that this healing would be quicker and rather than longer. We pray, Lord, that this that you would be with those in the medical profession and help them treat those who are sick. We pray, Lord, for the scientists and others that they would be able to develop treatments and a vaccine for this this pandemic. And we pray again all these things would happen sooner rather than later. Lord, I pray for those who are struggling through this time. Help them, Lord, with whatever their circumstances might be. The effects of this coronavirus are not just physical relating to health, but also can be economic, or they can be emotional, or they can be relational in nature. We pray for those struggling with those situations. We pray with those struggling for patience. We pray, Lord, for those who need encouragement and protection from turning to the wrong solutions during this time. Pray that you keep us all strong. Lord, we pray for, by name for certain people now. We pray for Darcy and Tammy and Jan and Juanita and Georgine, Lucy, Aria, Kelly, Jim, Annie, John, Charlotte, John and Joan, and also Phyllis and Al as well. Lord, we pray for comfort for the Shower family, for Joyce, Justin, Vanessa. Lord, we pray for continued safety and protection for Eleanor and Carolyn. Lord, we do pray, continue prayer for the Lang family, be with them during this time of transition. And now, Lord, we sum up all of our prayers in that perfect prayer that our good shepherd has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now receive the blessing of our Lord, our good shepherd. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor, and may he always give you his peace. Amen. And now in closing, I invite you to listen to the song Lamb of God by Twyla Paris, and especially listen to the words about our good shepherd and about how he became the Lamb of God for you and for me.